opportunity for you outside of the academic piece to say like, hey Johnny, you know, I noticed that you made a whole minute of that meditation being silent. It was awesome. I wonder if next time you can get through 2 minutes. You know, make it a challenge. Let's see if you can get through 2 minutes. Let's say they do get through 3 minutes and they're really great at the meditation and they can't focus in class at all. Draw that comparison for them. You just did that meditation for 3 whole minutes silently. I wonder if you could go do this math worksheet for 3 whole minutes silently. Use that same skill. So connect it somewhere where they can be successful. Like, kids can be successful with this. Oh, I can be successful in being focused in a meditation. I bet I now could be successful being focused with a math worksheet or whatever it is you're doing. So you can connect this to what you're doing in learning. I think that that's all I wanted to say about this. Are there any questions? Yes.
Is that going to be paraphrased?
Yeah, you can go on. If, like I said, I sign up as a teacher. So I don't think that they're like strict gatekeepers in this. They just put on their website that their goal was to get, every classroom in America to implement this, and they want people to do it. So it will just ask you what grade you work with, and then a username and password. So all the prior pros can use it. It's fine. Any other questions? I was going to lead you in a little meditation, but I think I'm going to run out of time. So I don't want to get to the other parts of my presentation. As I said, this is great for your whole class. But there's, of course, going to be, as Ms. Hilsman said, a lot of students who need more than just interventions in your classroom, and we want you to refer them as soon as possible. It's better to refer a kid and then I meet with them in the family and realize this isn't really a mental illness concern. There's something really brief we can do to tackle this than to overlook a kid who really needs help. So I put up here some signs that there might be a mental health concern. Really noticeable, just swift changes in emotional and behavioral functioning. I know that you all work very hard to form relationships with families, and so you might learn that there was just a separation in the family, or a parent is recently incarcerated, or a family was just became homeless. All of those kind of triggers are probably going to cause a lot of emotional problems for a child, and so you don't have to wait for a kid to start acting out or showing signs to say maybe you need mental health treatment. If you learn from a parent of a significant change, talk to them about it. Say like, hey, I know this could be hard for your kid. Have you thought about talking with one of our therapists who's here about how they could support with you through this transition, okay? If there's a persistently low or sudden decline in grades, frustration with work and avoiding work, your kids who are connected socially, I know, again, this is one of the signs of kids who maybe aren't acting out, but just aren't engaging with their peers. They aren't forming friendships or, they're not engaging with you even. That could be a sign of some depression or anxiety. And I mentioned at the bottom, be aware that finding kids with the more internal issues are going to be more of a challenge to identify. So that just takes one, letting them, educating them about mental health so that they feel comfortable coming to you for the older ones, and just knowing what's going on with their lives so that you can identify them quicker. So to refer a kiddo, our Lighthouse now has a full team that they hired to do just referrals and assessments. So they will receive all of the referrals from you. I know we kind of transitioned into this last year where the teacher had to fax or email in the referral instead of me doing that. We officially have our full team and they're in full swing. So they want to make sure that the referral is being driven by the teacher because you already have the relationship with the parent rather than myself. So I will make sure that I email back out that referral to you guys. It includes, you have to have the child's name, their address and phone number, a parent's name, those are the basics, date of birth, which I believe you can get all that for power. parts is we do need a social security number. So when you talk to the parent, make sure you let them know, I need your child's social security number before you can complete that referral and turn it in. You can either fax or email it. And last year, I actually went around and helped some teachers with this process the first few times, like filling it out. And even, like, I think Ms. Doctor and I did it together. We called a parent, we tried calling together. I am more than happy, especially if you've never done this, to come and do it with you a few times until you get used to it. I don't want you to feel like I'm not here to help at all. But we do want to make sure that you all are sending in those referrals. And last but not least, I mentioned this in one of the staff meetings last year. One of my goals is to do a much better job of being more consistent and communicating with you guys. Traditionally, I kind of showed up and then like, I'm here for Johnny. How's Johnny doing? Okay, bye. You know, and I could do a lot better job of being more consistent and getting feedback, following up on referrals. So I would like to start coming to some of your team meetings I think they're Tuesday mornings, the Tuesday morning meetings. So I'll rotate through those. I don't want to take up all your time, but I do want to let you know, like, okay, you sent in this referral. Here's where it is, the status. Are there any other kiddos you've been trying to get a referral for? And are there barriers? How are these kids doing that are in treatment? And answer any questions that you have. So that's my plan this year, to try to do a better job of that. And I believe that was all. Are there any questions? That was 15 minutes. I'm sweating. Thank you very much. I'm so excited to work with you all.
Okay, you guys. We are a crisis team here at Evanston. Ms. Geiser, Mr. Ayers, can you raise your hand? And Mr. Williams and I. If you are in crisis with a child and it happens, we'll come out. We'll support you guys. But I want to be real transparent. As most of you guys know, I have a child with a disability. My station has a tic disorder, which is in the Tourette's family. We moved her from the district we live in to Cincinnati Public Schools because nobody does it better than we do. Nobody does it better than Evanston. But you have to remember, you want to show the kids the grace that you would have someone show you, or your child, or your grandchild. My other school district, which shall remain nameless, it wasn't that they weren't doing that. They did their best. And they did an okay job. But I knew that Cincinnati Public does it better than everybody else. I'm not asking you guys to relax expectations. Your expectations are your expectations. Every teacher in this class, para in this room, paras, everybody has a set of expectations. We want you guys to continue with that. However, sometimes my stage, she might need a little extra love and care. She might need a little breathe to relax. When we were in our therapy, they gave us an app, breathe to relax. I'm telling you, Ms. Relye, sometimes her and I are doing the breathe to relax. I need the extra therapy. Don't hesitate to give a child some grace. That's what makes Evanston better than everybody else, because we do that. Don't relax your expectations. Mr. Williams and I are not saying don't.